all, I thank the organizers for giving me this opportunity to share my views and also to make the public what we have done related to biofortification in pearl millet. Just now you have heard from Liberty, which was mentioning about the things what we have done in the first time in the world for pearl millet. So today I'm going to talk about the journey from biofortification in food crops to fixing benchmarks for micronutrient content in varietal identification and release of pearl millet. So if you see the present day challenges we see in agriculture or any as such today, we are faced with the overbulging population, global warming, water scarcity, and malnutrition. And these are the challenges, common global challenges, and we many people from different disciplines, not only agriculture, medicine, and other fields are also trying to address these global challenges. So today we are talking about biofortification, and this is related to nutrition. And if you talk about micronutrient malnutrition, this is one of the global challenges. It is nothing but also called as hidden hunger. It is due to the inadequate accessibility of minerals and vitamins in our diets. Micronutrients, though as the term mentions, they are required in very less quantity, they play a crucial role in human health. In early 90s, this problem commanded global attention, and it was alarming, very alarming in developing countries who are predominantly based on cereal-based diets. And two-thirds of the population in the world depends on cereal and sugar crops-based food, which mostly lack essential micronutrients. Now, some of the facts which I want to put before you, there are 16 essential minerals which are essentially required for humans, of which 5 minerals, namely iodine, iron, zinc, calcium, and selenium, are limiting in our food, resulting in deficiency. And globally, 1 out of every 3 persons is suffering from ill health due to deficiency of one or the other micronutrients, which I mentioned just now. Among all these micronutrients, iron and zinc deficiency accounts for more than 2 billion globally, and most susceptible being the pregnant women and children below the age of 5. And 1/3 of the 2 billion people suffering from micronutrient malnourishment around the world is from India alone. And in India, the annual losses due to iron deficiency is nearly 4 million disability adjusted life years. And for zinc, it is about 2.8 million disability adjusted life years. So this is the importance of these micronutrients. If you see, just now I mentioned, there are micronutrients that are there which are essential. On a whole, if you see, we need 51 essential nutrients for sustaining the human life. The 3 most important things, air, water, oxygen, the energy, that is oxygen, water, carbohydrates, 9 amino acids, histidine, isoleucine, leucine, lysine, methionine, phenylalanine, threonine, tryptophan, and valine. 2 fatty acids, linoleic and linolenic acids. 7 macro elements, sodium, potassium, calcium, magnesium, sulfur, phosphorus, and chlorine. 17 micro elements, of which I highlighted 2 here, iron and zinc, about which I'm going to speak today. And 13 vitamins, including A, D, E, K, C, and vitamin B complex. And just now I mentioned that globally 1 in every 3 persons is malnourished, and we are in the middle of this global crisis. If you look into the consequences of this micronutrient malnutrition, they cause higher morbidity, higher mortality, lower cognitive ability, lower work productivity, impaired growth, and impaired reproduction. people may be wondering why she's talking about all these things, because my talk is something related to pulmonary biofortification. Yes, with this introduction thing, I just wanted to take you along why we are going for biofortification of the food crops, and from there how we have come to the setting up of benchmarks for release and identification and release of cultivars. And hidden hunger, it affects across the life in all the different stages, right from starting in the newborns to children, adolescents, pregnant women, adults, and seniors. The kind of effects it puts on different stages is in newborns, it leads to low birth weight, high mortality, reduced mental development, and the child will be often ill. And in children, it leads to stunting, they fall often ill of the small stature, high mortality, and low resilience. And in adults, they'll be stunted with reduced mental and physical performance. And in pregnant ladies, it leads to high mortality, frequent perinatal complications, lower performance. And in adults, they'll be poor, malnourished, and limited productivity. And seniors, they have lower life expectancy, and they often fall chronically ill. So none of the life stage is without this hidden hunger effects. So one has to take care that in all through the our life stages, we have to have proper nutrition to avoid all these ill effects. Now, nutrition as a first line of defense. We have already and witnessed going through this corona pandemic. Now everyone realizes what is the importance of immunity and from where this immunity is coming. And we know that whatever we are eating, whatever we take, imparts to our health and immunity. So there is no doubt to say that nutrition is the first line of defense. And food systems are as much a part of a future solution as they are part of the current problem. So if we have any problem, it is also because of the food habits. And if we have any solution, it also is coming from the food habits. So everything lies in the food we take. And the most immediate frontline defense for people against infections is a healthy immunity system. And essential micronutrients such as zinc, vitamin A, and iron have a crucial role to play in building an immune system. And efforts to deliver micronutrients to vulnerable populations have used strategies such as biofortification, which use conventional plant breeding methods to increase the micronutrient content in the staple crops that are commonly produced and eaten every day. So biofortification is targeting those crops which are being consumed daily. And biofortification is shown to improve not only the micronutrient status, but also health outcomes, including cognitive and physical function, stronger immune systems, and lower morbidity to a range of diseases. And we have already seen in the world that food fortification is already in place. Worldwide, salt is being fortified with iodine. In countries like Zambia, sugar is fortified with vitamin A. In Bangladesh, vegetable oil is fortified with vitamin A. India, wheat flour is fortified with iron and folic acid. African countries with these things. And many other countries have different products which are being fortified with essential nutrients. Now, before I go into that thing, I just wanted to make a clear distinction between what is fortification and biofortification. Because this group is a wide, varied group comprising students, faculty, teachers, and many people. So for the benefit of the audience, I'm trying to bring out the difference between fortification and biofortification. Fortification is the practice of deliberately increasing the content of an essential micronutrient, that is vitamins and minerals, in a food so as to improve the nutritional quality of the food supply and provide a public health benefit with minimal risk to the health. Whereas biofortification is the process by which the nutritional quality of food crops is improved through agronomic practices, conventional plant breeding, or through modern biotechnology. Now, so biofortification aims to increase nutrient levels in crops during plant growth rather than through manual means during processing. So this is something which is being incorporated during the plant growth rather than the processing things. So it is a way, therefore, to reach populations where supplementation and conventional fortification activities may be difficult to implement or are limited. So if you look into the genesis of this word, it is coming from Greek word bios means life, and a Latin word fortificare means making strong. So this is a combination of a Greek and Latin word, and it is defined as the breeding of food crops that are rich in bioavailable micronutrients. And this concept was given by Howard Boyce when he had made a study when he was at IFRI in Washington. And they have made a study and found out that the difference of health between rich and poor is based on the level of non-staple food consumption. Staple food means either rice, wheat, or maize, or something which covers major chunk of your energy in the form of carbohydrate. But the non-staple food means something like fruits, vegetables, dry fruits, and all these things which are rich in vitamins, minerals, etc. So his study concluded that mineral and vitamin deficiencies and not the calories were the main constraints to better nutrition and therefore to healthy and economically productive lives. So based on the report he generated from his study, it made people think, what if we could make plants to do some work for us? In other words, if we can produce new variety of seed that is higher in iron or zinc. In addition, farmers and consumers would not see or taste that extra iron or zinc, but their intake would be substantially increased if it is combined with the staple food. And small farmers they grow the nutritious staple food and also consume it. And what if plants needed minerals for their nutrition, not only for human health, even these micronutrients are essential for the plant health also. And research has shown that seedlings with higher zinc content are more vigorous and viable, not only in wheat. Similar kind of results are observed in different crops as well. And therefore, the intersection between nutrition and agriculture suggested that if we could find a way to increase the vitamin and mineral content of staple foods grown and consumed by smallholder farmers, we could solve the problem of hidden hunger. And thus, the intersection between nutrition and agriculture led to biofortification. So this is what about biofortification. Now, if you look into the science of biofortification, conventional plant breeding began hundreds of years ago. And every farmer chooses the best looking plants and seeds and he saves them for the next year's planting. And as the science of genetics was better understood, plant breeders were able to select certain desirable traits in a plant to create improved varieties of plants. Now, the projects of biofortification around the world focus on three crucial micronutrients that are limited in diets of the poor. There are three. There are one, vitamin A, number two, iron, and three, zinc. And breed them into the key food crops. So, when we talk of breeding for biofortification, the steps we have to follow would be, first step in developing a biofortified crop is to screen the existing crop varieties and accessions in the global germplasm collection to evaluate the extent of genetic diversity and then identify your sources, maybe with the higher content or the lower content. The source of genetic variation is important for the next step in breeding because almost all the students of plant breeding very well know and understand the importance of genetic variation, creation of it, and then selection of the variants. So pre-breed, if it is available in some wild material, then pre-breeding is required if micronutrient variation is discovered in a strategic gene. And if micronutrient variation is present in the gene pool, materials may be used directly to develop new varieties. Then parent plants with high vitamin or mineral levels across several generations to produce plants with desired micronutrient content and other traits important for acceptance by farmers and consumers. Then once we have got that material with high desired micronutrient content, the next step is to thoroughly test it. So newly selected micronutrient dense lines in experimental station in farmer space. The plants are evaluated for their yield and other agronomic traits, including tolerance to major pests and diseases. This is what we also do in a normal development of any crop variety. These evaluations are done in comparison to the best available local cultivars. The influence of varying climatic and soil conditions is also studied, as well as performance and the different agronomic management practices is also studied. And this part is done through multi-locational evaluation. Then the seeds of the best performing materials are then multiplied and made available as public goods to national governments, which officially release the new crop varieties and are supplied to the farmers. So before we go for breeding for better nutrition, there are certain points which needs to be considered. The first point is aim at combining high nutrient density with high yields and high profitability. If we just blindly breed for high micronutrient content, there will be no takers. Even if you go and say to the farmer, see, this particular variety has 1000 ppm of iron, he will not take it. Unless and until there is high yield, which in turn results in good economic returns, no farmer is going to take your variety. So the first and foremost step is to combine the high nutrient density with high yields for high profitability. Then the micronutrient enrichment levels. Yes, we started combining these two traits, but then you should select for micronutrient, enhanced micronutrient levels along with the yields. Then third, you have to look for the stability of the micronutrient enriched traits. Then efficacy must be demonstrated, and then only the so-called biofortified variety or crop will be adopted by the farmers and then by the consumers. So if you look into different breeding approaches for biofortification, you can either go by conventional approaches or through biotechnological approaches. So if you look into the process, first we go for screening of the genetic diversity for micronutrients in the available germplasm. We select that material. We go for allele discovery or through routine conventional plant breeding, we go for identifying of the improved cultivar with increased micronutrient content. Or by using different techniques like QTL analysis, you identify the trait specific molecular markers, or you identify the gene, then allele discovery, use them through different marker techniques and then go for development of the improved cultivar, or you can do the genomic analysis, go for the gene discovery, take the help of bioinformatics and functional analysis, again come back to the allele discovery, maybe through the normal breeding or through the genetic engineering, you can come down to an improved cultivar. So once the challenge in biofortification is putting together all of the pieces of the puzzle to create a micronutrient rich crop that is acceptable to both farmers and consumers. For farmers, it should be economically profitable along with high yield. For consumers, it should be acceptable in the original form without affecting their established taste and color and all other factors, organoleptic factors. So the advantages are, it is built on what poor households grow and eat, that is on staple foods. One-time investment to develop seeds that fortify themselves, keeping recurrent costs low, and the germplasm, that is the living tissue from which the plants can be grown, can be shared globally, making it highly cost effective. Otherwise, if you have to synthesize artificially, you have to go for manufacturing or other things. Because it is a living tissue, it can replicate in terms of through breeding, it can be shared, and it can be used. Biofortification is sustainable. Long after people stop thinking about biofortification, farmers continue to grow and eat their biofortified crops. Biofortification reaches the country's most vulnerable people living in remote rural areas with no access or money for commercially marketed biofortified foods. And biofortification produces high yields in an environmentally friendly way, no side effects on the environment. And it is one solution to reduce hidden hunger worldwide. And it is the process by which the nutritional quality of food crops is improved through agronomic practices, conventional plant breeding, or modern biotechnological tools. So there are many biofortification projects taken up all over the world. Some of the things are here, mentioning here. One is iron biofortification. It is used in rice, beans, sweet potato, millets, cassava, and legumes. Zinc biofortification, done in case of wheat, rice, beans, sweet potato, and maize. Provitamin E or carotenoid, the biofortification used in sweet potato, maize, and cassava. Amino acid and protein biofortification in case of sorghum and cassava. In India, biofortification projects were funded by DBT and ICAR. At the world level, it was done by Harvest Plus. At national level, both by DBT and in ICAR, there is a special CRP on biofortification, which includes major crops like rice, wheat, maize, pearl millet, small millet, and sorghum. And today we have, there are biofortified varieties released in more than 30 countries and are being tested and grown in more than 40 countries. I'm just trying to go through some of the slides to show what are the different varieties released at different points of time across the world. I'm just going through this. In rice, biofortified, the micronutrient targeted was zinc. The country was Bangladesh. Brazil lead institutions were ERI, BRRI, EMBRAPA in 2013 and 14. A provitamin A, Philippines. You all know that golden rice developed at ERI. For iron, Bangladesh and India. Then iron, China. Many countries have started working in this direction on staple food crops. You all know about the golden rice. This is one of the solutions sort targeted for addressing vitamin A deficiency. For the sake of people who do not know about golden rice, it is a genetically engineered rice which can produce and accumulate beta carotene, that is provitamin A, inside the rice endosperm. So this is your normal white rice. And this is your golden rice. I'm not going to explain these things, but for the sake of the students who would like to go through, they can go through the articles related to golden rice. Here, the genes were taken for phytoin synthase, lycopene synthase, and phytoin desaturase were taken from daffodils and Erbinia bacteria, and they were transferred to plasmids and then transformed to agrobacterium, and then they got transgenic rice, which is rich in white this beta carotene, and later it was termed as golden rice. There are different versions of golden rice available. First one was a prototype. It was having 1.6 micrograms per gram of golden rice beta carotene. Then golden rice one, after changing the promoter, they got 5 to 7 micrograms of beta carotene per gram. Then golden rice 2, it was the genes was changed from the daffodil to maize gene phytoin synthase, where they could get 31 micrograms of beta carotene per gram of the thing. So you can see the variants. This is the normal rice, golden rice 1 and golden rice 2. With increase in the content of the beta carotene, you can see the change in color also. That was at the national level. At in India, micronutrient content was, efforts were made in different crops to increase these micronutrient contents. They also have fixed some benchmarks to develop rice varieties. For zinc, they have kept 28 ppm. For iron, they have kept 10 ppm. For protein, they have kept more than 10%. And we have different rice varieties like CR Dan at 310, which has 10.3% of the protein. This comes under a bioportfed rice variety. And zinc, 22.6 ppm. It is DRR Dan 45. For wheat, in the international level, these are the efforts taken by different countries for zinc. It was efforts are being made by India, Pakistan, China, Brazil, and other countries. And many biofortified wheat varieties with different levels of zinc were developed. And in ICR at the national level, we have WB02, which has zinc 42 ppm and iron 40 ppm. And then HPBW01, where iron is 40 ppm and zinc is 40.6 ppm, released by different centers under ICAR. In maize, the nutrient targeted was provitamin A. Different countries like Zambia, Nigeria, Brazil. Also in India, efforts were made by different institutions. The material developed in India for maize is Pusa Vivek Pure PM9 Improved, where the provitamin A content is about 8.15 ppm. Lysine is 2.67 ppm. Tryptophan is 0.74%. And in Pusa HM4 Improved, tryptophan is 0.91 and lysine is 3.62. Then Pusa HM8 Improved, tryptophan is 1.06%, lysine is 4.18%. Pusa HM9 Improved, it is tryptophan 0.68%, lysine 2.97%.